This is day one of the June 96 10-day retreat in Springwater. Last night in the opening talk, I forgot to say a few words about the walking. It just occurred right now while we were walking. And the questions that people sometimes ask about walking, particularly if one has not been to a retreat like this before, in which there is walking between periods of quiet sitting. First of all, there is no obligation to participate in the walking. Some people feel 25 minutes is not very long, not enough for them to sit. So it's quite all right to sit through the walking period. One can sit 55 or minutes or an hour. Or to go to the balcony to walk quietly, slowly, onto the dining room. Oh, right now we have enough room in here that one can find a slow walking lane right here that doesn't interfere with other people walking. Or catch a breath of fresh air stepping out of the door onto the deck or in front of the house. The question that is often asked is, what is the walking for? What are we walking for? Why the walking? One explanation that could be given is that it's good for the body to move after having been very still and quiet for a period of time. And if one feels the quiet sitting is interrupted by the walking, question further, what is it that is being interrupted? Needs to be no interruption in attending, from sitting motionlessly to rising and walking, feeling the touch of the soles on the wooden floor, the changing light as one walks from one room into another, the changing temperature often. Not that the brain has to verbally register all of that. It happens, it's going on. In a quiet motion, which needs not interrupt awareness. As for this fundamental question that we are compelled to ask all the time, what is this for? Why? What do I gain from it? Can one ask another question? Is it possible to take one step without purpose? One step at a time, without knowing the gain, the purpose, the why and how. Just the happening of it in the midst of rustling leaves and words being spoken, birds singing, calling. To feel the motion, the vibrations of this compelling, what's the good of it? Why? What for? The purpose, the meaning of it. To feel the program running itself. How it keeps the body, mind, in a certain perpetual tension of expectation of something to come, something good or something bad or something worse. And the possibility of a switch to just being here. Program or no program, experiencing what is there in all simplicity. So, one step without an expectation of the next step, or a step 10 minutes hence, or a year from now. To see the thoughts running without being captured totally by it. Remain with a step by step. Because it is so utterly important, on the first day, we speak about a new listening, alone and together. When we're really alone, we're also together. A new listening, which isn't totally pushed and pulled by expectation, but listens as we just talked, listens to the sound of expectation without finding fault with it, giving it all the space there is. This is a universe of infinite space, and then some more. Space for everything that's happening, for everyone to be just the way he or she is right at this moment, which need not last, need not be rejected or grasped or avoided or fought or changed. The change is always just being here with what's there. That's the change. Not changing what comes into perception, into awareness, and in our compulsive way wanting to be rid of that or change it, make it better. The change is this vast, unlimited listening space with no purpose, no goal to attain. Obviously, there's no goal to attain because everything is right here, not a distance of time or space away in an imagined future. Future only exists in the imagination. The past only exists in memory. You could say, well, what about a dinosaur bone? Does that exist in memory? No, that is right here. Not here right now. Right now it's in the imagination, this dinosaur bone. But if one is right in front of it or digs it up out of a layer of earth, it's here now. Takes thought and theory and knowledge to link it up in what we call evolutionary time. But at the moment of discovery, it's here with a sweat pouring off the brow and the trees trembling. So, can there be moments of bare attention, naked awareness, with no need to drape concepts or connections around what reveals itself from moment to moment. The sound of bird airplane and trees shaking is all here now. Also the words that are spoken. But these words, as they are spoken, do not interfere with the wholeness of perception, do not need to interfere. Very often, until this wholeness of perception manifests quite effortlessly, there is a caught upness in the names and in the descriptions and words and concepts. Seems impossible to get out of that brainy network of knowing or needing to know verbally, conceptually, what it is that is taking place. This compulsion is of the strongest of programs and very helpful for survival of the organism and the species. Human beings have evolved this way and survived through incredible feats of knowledge and remembrance and prediction. Without any guarantee that we will survive forever, because this has overgrown its functionality and begins to oppress us with fear and anxiety or greed and ambition. So, how do we listen this moment? I don't mean the explanation of it through the ear and ear canal and drums and bones and auditory nerve, but from the inside, listening without knowing. And even if the knowledge imposes itself and wants to take over, to question into this, needing to know and to discover how we feel secure or pseudo-secure because we know something, and to question that. Because it's just a habit to think that because we know, we are more secure. I'm talking right now of this meditative sitting and listening, not our daily jobs where knowledge is tightly interwoven into our moment-to-moment fabric of being. But here, it's hardly necessary at all. That's the beauty of a 10-day retreat. To let it turn into a vacation from knowing, a vacation from expecting, a vacation from purpose and meaning. Our habitual, what does it mean, pointing towards something else. And allowing this moment of listening to insect humming to be freed of a purpose and therefore so clear, so present, so meaningful in itself without pointing toward anything else that thought may have to provide. Maybe a first talk is hard to follow. I mentioned here in the last retreat in Sweden that people have told me that often they hear hardly anything of the first talk. The mind drifts off or is dozy, sleepy. Maybe on day 3 or 4, one hears a little bit more. I mentioned that in some connection. And the man who was sitting next to me, who was recording these taping these talks, told him he was challenged by what I said because he thought he was listening. And he was hearing the tape afterwards in his room or wherever, probably not in his room, there were eight of them. And he said, it was amazing, at least 50% I missed. Didn't hear it at all. Would have never known that you said that. I played it again and realized that I still had missed some. He was quite delighted by his discovery about his certainties and how frail and fallible they were. That's the spirit of discovery. It happens this way. When we really discover something that is true about ourselves, we don't worry about it. There is the joy of discovery. And then if somebody else says to us, this is what I've observed about you, we don't need to be defensive because we've discovered it ourselves. It is so. We're only defensive about things that we haven't really completely looked at because we like to stick to the image of ourselves. We're more comfortable with imagining how we are or ought to be and fear the pain of discovering how we really are. But when that discovery actually takes place, there's nothing threatening in it because discovery is joyful in and of itself, regardless of what it reveals. What it reveals is the truth about a human being, which I happen to call me, or you. What difference does it make? So in listening to a talk, can one question the expectations that are there? Because usually we bring expectations. We want to hear what we like to hear or what we have heard before to confirm our understanding. We are afraid of hearing certain things. And these wants and fears that infiltrate our listening, clouded, distorted, and that is something to be discovered by each one of us. How expectation, fearful or hopeful, distorts, narrows the channel of reception, the openness. Actually, the openness doesn't even feel like a channel. As a channel when I want to hear something, or a dark tunnel when I am afraid of hearing something, which brings up anger, fight, defensiveness. So, to question one's expectations of the person who is giving a talk or holding meetings. Does one have expectations of Toni? Images of her? I'm talking of myself in the third person to look at it with you. Objectively, openly, neutrally. It's this rare kind of listening that is without expectation, without imagery of the person who's talking. But it's possible. Even though it's rare, it's possible. This is meditative listening. Not to uphold or maintain an image of the speaker, but to listen and look while things are being said. Is it really so? Not analytically, that's switching into a very narrow channel. But as one looks, maybe evokes something that is being talked about, like image making, and verifies in the process, yes, this is so, or I don't see that. Not to jump to conclusions that I'm wrong or she is wrong, but to sift through what is happening from moment to moment. The difficulty of looking, the resistance to looking, or the clarity of looking. Linked with expectations and fears, and this tremendous compulsion to maintain our imagery. Because up till now, we live much more in imagery than in reality. That is a fact to be discovered by each one of us. The power of the imagery that the brain keeps churning out or repeating. The power and the comfort of it. It seems to be easier to live and continue to live in the world of imagination than to face facts. It's a different kind of energy to live facing facts. It seems to be more routine and habitual and therefore easier, relaxing, if you will, to go with the imagination, with the thinking and imaging. Which, unless one has discovered this, one may dispute and say, no, to imagine something for me is hard. Then one hasn't watched moment-to-moment living. We've called someone up in the village of Dansville to help us with our garden, the borders. I can't do the work so much anymore with the back, and Kyle isn't up to that. So a man came up, and he's just full of imagination. He's already been up 3 times, but he hasn't done anything yet. It's not true. He did come up once and rip some bushes out. But since then, and I talked to him again yesterday on the phone, because he was going to be there the beginning or middle of the week to put some things into the border. Because now he has a changed work schedule, which is quite understandable. But it's so palpable how he lives and what he's going to do with this border. And he talks and tells me, and he's very knowledgeable, he's got a degree in landscape architecture, and tells me what other people who don't have that training do wrong, planting things too close, too evergreen, too this or that. Yesterday I said, I'd like to see something. So when he has time, he said he'd come up and talk with Kyle. I warned Kyle. He's a very nice man, very sweet. Both Kyle and the landscaper. So this really ties in with the other topic that I usually have for the first talk, this whole topic of creating or fighting authority. These talks are not given to propound things, to get my view across or my beliefs. I don't have beliefs. I just look at things with or without people. It's to share, to kindle in ourselves the interest, to step out of this imaginary world. And by imaginary, I don't just mean fairies and all kinds of imagined story, fairy tale story figures, but our thinking about ourselves and each other into watching, attending. It's a new world, a different world. So, if I say something in a talk and it doesn't ring a bell, it doesn't bring sort of a responsive, vibrating, if you will, yeah, this is, but no, this is not so. Can't, I've seen this differently. Then to follow it up with meetings, group or individual, and by oneself, to look again, freshly, not to defend one's first impressions, and to notice how we're liable to defend our first impressions, because now we're hooked again on an image of ourselves. We want to be consistent. We don't want to lose. Don't want to be weak. All of the stuff that we're carrying around. So useless as the husks of corn. Just good for fertilizing. So, talk is not here, is not given to establish my authority. This is a totally foreign view and feeling and image to me, to become authority to people, to be followed, led, to be followed or to be led. The respect that is here for human beings and non-human beings is great and deep. So how would one want to impose things on human beings who can find out for themselves? And yet pointing out things is helpful. I know it myself. It's been helpful all my life to read or hear someone who clearly puts something and points to something, whether I understand it intellectually or not. And in the past, the less I've understood it intellectually, the more challenging it has become. What is the person talking about? Where are they coming from? How could anybody say this? Not as an exclamation of anger or despair, but interest. And yet, the desire to create authority is there in us. It probably dates back to our very beginnings in this life, being so helpless, so in need of parents, loving parents, strong parents, guiding parents. And maybe we never had enough of it, or we had too much of it. We want to continue that and find people who parent us. Amazing. We've never grown up, or have we? And to watch what goes with this desire to find one's authority. Somebody in whom one can believe, whom one can follow. Unquestioningly. To watch how the brain begins building up that person as an image, and then living with the image rather than with the real relationship. And noticing things that are going on in this relationship of domination and subjugation, worship, putting oneself down, thinking one is not as far, not as knowledgeable, not as this or that. And the other person has all of that. And wanting it to keep it that way, and then the crash, the disappointment, when one finds out the person is not perfect, has a personality like everyone else. Even though in talking, the personality is often not touched by teachers, spiritual teachers. Not their own, not other people's. One tries to go to the spiritual level in which personality problems don't exist, and yet we don't live in retreats and meetings and talks all the time with that rare energy of looking and attending and awareness. So the personality is to be observed very scrutinizingly, clearly, non-romantically. non-defensively. And also with the desire to create authority goes, for all of us who are driven by this desire, the desire to fight it. It's been amazing to me in these years of doing this work how some people have created things out of me and then fight it, attack it. What one is attacking is one's own desire for refuge, for following, for remaining a child, a helpless one, a dependent one. So can all of this ongoing thing in our relationship with each other air out, come to the light of day, be seen and discovered with amazement, not with fault finding or guilt, although these things happen, and to expose it, to expose guilt feelings and wonder about the depth and strength of them. Expose everything and wonder about its depth and strength to keep this body-mind chained in habit, unseen, unfelt, undiscovered habit. And yet, the amazing possibility of discovering it after 68 years, or 77, or however long it may take to discover one habit that one hasn't discovered yet, and it's been running all the time unattended. And yet the beauty of it, the moment it is discovered, it doesn't have to keep running, because now there is attention, a benign, non-judging attention, which exposes and understands how human beings react and interrelate habitually. A thing which has been brought up to me more recently by a few people is, why do you deny your authority? Because you do have an authoritative voice and presentation, and it's good for somebody to speak authoritatively with energy. And I'm glad this was brought up to me, because that's not what I mean when I say I'm no authority. I can feel the energy when things are clear, the energy to present clearly and often passionately what is seen to be so, and the willingness to meet with each other and look at it anew, not needing to be apologetic about saying something, and yet flexible to look again. Yes, it is so, or no, it isn't quite so, or at least the words that are being used could be improved upon. Because that's usually where our problems lie, how things are expressed. Of course, the problem lies primarily with not seeing clearly. But then to put it into clear, unconfusing words is yet another difficulty. It needs a lot of energy and flexibility. So no, I don't deny the energy that wells up for looking at things and expressing them and checking them out together, and to understand that this is helpful. I know it myself, I find it helpful when somebody is clear and strong about something, yet flexible. So that's not what is meant by denying. I don't even deny Do I deny? Maybe I do. Don't see myself as setting up authority in order to be followed, adored, worshipped. These things destroy the immediacy and beauty of our spontaneous relationship with each other. If there's adoration creeping in, when one can see it in the eyes, they reflect the presence of ideas and imagery in the absence of immediacy. So what is our relationship to each other if the habitual or customary relationship of student-teacher or student and authority doesn't apply, doesn't work? Is one at a loss then how to relate to each other? That's when relationship starts. When our customary categories break down, we're at a loss of knowing who we are, and therefore maybe opening up to this instant of being there together in a fresh way. Call it a way of friendship, intimacy, or respect, all of that. And yet not to cling to the words. We can enchant ourselves and inspire ourselves with words and savor the physical reactions to the inspiration of words. But that's sort of a detour. Not needed. And yet when it happens, it happens. Maybe the daily energy for living through a day is generated by a lot of these little thoughts about people, about the future, about the past, something I look forward to, and zingo, a little shot, a little fix of energy. One can notice it. It's already happened. By the time one notices, it's already happened. At that moment of awareness, one may just watch, it is now going to be milked and thought about more and more, or because awareness is there, that's the end of inspiring oneself just by thinking about what's going to happen to me in the future. Because when there's awareness, there is the presence, and that does not need inspiration. It is fullness itself, while being empty of imagery. We will end here for today.